I'm not sure that we have a regional approach in the US whereby 10 county school districts come together and agree upon a curriculum, which I'll tell you a little bit more about in a second, to establish career academies for their schools in secondary ed. So that's the website address, NorthwestFloridaManufacturersCouncil.org. And let's see if we can get the clicker going. Find the right radio frequency here.
Is it working?
The big button, right?
It should be.
There's one on either side.
Yeah, there's a forward and back on the side.
There you go.
Excellent. All right. Before we get started in talking about these career academies, I have a little quiz for you. What's 50 years old with more than 80,000 professionals spread across every state in the country and many countries?
Is it manufacturing?
Before we get started on manufacturing, where do I work?
University of West Florida.
Yes, indeed. So University of West Florida, we're almost 50 years old, and we have a football team now, Go Argos. So please do send your sons and daughters. They will succeed in many different sectors of the economy, but we look forward to having them on our beautiful campus in Pensacola, Florida, or on our new online global campus.
So. Nicole, I have been certainly a longtime worker at UWS, so I would be glad to send any information to you.
Outstanding, Christy. I appreciate that. So that concludes my advertisement for the morning. But now back to the work at hand. We had a common problem, one that I've heard about for the last 2 days. And what is that? Talent. We don't have an adequate supply, whether you're in the energy sector, the medical sector, IT, or manufacturing. So we're going to talk through a timeline because the demand for technical professionals is at an all-time high, whether it's retirements or lack of skills or lack of interest in the field. That's the challenge that we all face as employers, right? So in Gulf Power's thinking, they decided to get together a group called the Technical Skills Task Force, and they started to research the skills gap and really try to quantify what it means to the 10-county region of Northwest Florida. That began in 2013. The research results came back, and we put together what we call ManuFacts. Manufacturing contributed $2.6 billion in gross domestic product for our region, and it represents about 14,500 jobs in our region. So when we got started, I really had no idea that number of jobs was attributed to this particular sector. I have to give credit to my university for this research. The late Dr. Rod Lewis, who is head of the Haas Center, actually spearheaded this particular research project. So thanks to the Haas Center and Dr. Lewis for his good research. It contributes a lot of money in earnings, and the wages are very, very high relative to other sectors of the economy. So if you're going to go and work in tourism and hospitality, it's going to take you a while to get $67,000, right out of trade school, high school, or college. So the average wage is high. They get a technical degree after 2 years of school. Well, one preacher is required. You guys know exactly what happens. But that's a pretty high starting wage, especially in the northern part of the state. So then Dr. Lewis, Jennifer Grove at Gulf Power, they started to share the findings and bring people together. And the result of that, but not only did Gulf Power get together with education to do the research, they also identified key industry partners in manufacturing. They also pulled in CareerSource Florida, and Jennifer, I believe, was the chair of CareerSource Florida at the time. So she convened the four workforce boards in our 10-county region and made sure that they were at the table to educate us about the available labor pool. And then they started the Northwest Florida Manufacturers Council. I believe that was mid-2013. Here are the list of members that we have at this time, and we hope to grow that number of members. We encourage affiliates, those service partners who support the manufacturing sector, as well as manufacturers to get in touch and join us. We also have education partners and, of course, the career source boards, too. So armed with a new council and many advocates and cheerleaders in manufacturing, they started to generate interest in the particular issues that were at hand. So what do you guess we need to replace in the next 5 years in terms of manufacturing employment? What's the percentage?
60.
Actually, a little less, about 29% as of the research findings in 2014. Here's another quick quiz for you. How many people do they actually need for those jobs? So I already mentioned we have about 14,500 jobs in the sector right now. How many?
42, 45.
Yeah, about 4,000, right. Thank you. Smart group. Okay. There we go. So this became the priority for the council, to increase and improve the talent pipeline. So that takes those who are growing the young students, that takes those who are training the adults, and also the educators in post-secondary. So again, we're looking at this entire pipeline, and how can we increase and improve the number of people? So we're going to develop a plan, and we're going to identify funding, because nothing's free, right? Education's expensive. The alternative is more expensive. So Jennifer Grove led the task force for the educators and career source board members, pulled together a plan. We're looking at the USDOL pyramid that describes the various competencies for the manufacturing sector. And she wanted to have stackable credentials and degrees with a pathway for these students to re-enter education after they've earned a job, got a position, and moved into their adult life. So I'm going to ask one of our VIPs in the back, who's on his phone right now, Mr. Steve Harrell.